Welcome back to the Cross Border Interview Podcast. It is our very first season three entertainment rundown with our entertainment reporter, our pundit, our man in the sky, our man in the States, Mr. Michael Nichols Pate. Did I get it right?
You did.
Yes.
That deserves a RuPaul Vogue.
Okay, well, we can talk about RuPaul as well if you want, because I have not been tuning in, and the episode will be airing the day after the next episode drops. So, we have a lot to cover. We have not talked entertainment on the show since June of 2021. It's been a long 2.5 months of no entertainment. It seems to be one of the most popular segments on the show, so we thought, why not make it a regular standing monthly show? The last Friday of every month, we will be talking about the biggest entertainment news stories here in North America, but also sometimes around the world. And I also want to say, we will be also talking about award shows. We'll have our entertainment Emmy night recap. We'll have our Oscar night. We'll have our Tonys. And we will have a lot to digest over the next few months. And Michael has graciously accepted the role of coming on the show every month at the end of the month and all the award shows. So I'm happy. Thank you so much for doing this. This is the most long-winded introduction I've ever done for someone. But Michael, thank you so much for doing this.
Absolutely. I have my teacup ready. I'm ready to spill some tea.
I got my Mysterio water cup.
Is the Tonys even happening still? I feel like we're never going to find out if Aaron Tveit, the only nominated, is actually going to win the award or not.
At this point of time, if they don't hold it in the next 2 months, I think they have to throw up their hands and say, enough's enough. We're just moving forward with 2021-2022 season, because at this point in time, Broadway is back on, right? I remember Stephen Colbert sort of making a joke about it on his nightly show. This was not planned in the rundown of what we were going to be talking about, guys.
No, it wasn't. Surprise.
Exactly. This is the great thing about the show. But I think Broadway's slowly getting back up and running.
September, Labor Day weekend was when I heard a lot of shows were coming back. Maybe they've done it sooner. Maybe that gets paused because of Miss Delta work. I don't know. But who knows? It's a journey. We're all going on it in the Broadway community. Some of us are losing our jobs in the Broadway community, but that's none of my business.
Sipping the tea. Good for you. I should also mention that we are now no longer talking to Michael in California over the summer. He did move. He is now closer to Broadway. He is in upstate New York. I'm hopefully okay with saying that out loud, but I'm not saying what city, what town, and all that, but he is in New York now. So we now have we could literally have you report live from outside Broadway if we have to.
You sure could. I mean, there'd be a lot of people, and Times Square is a nightmare. I'd probably want to punch somebody in the face, but hey, who knows? It's an adventure.
Who'd have had it on their calendar 5 minutes into the show and we've already threatened someone with violence? Good times. Good times.
It's a journey. I'm a New Yorker. We do that.
Exactly. I want to talk about the elephant in the room. One of the biggest things that has happened over the last few months since we last talked was movie theaters began opening up here in Canada, in the States. I'm not sure how that was. They did start opening up over the summer. So this has seen a change of how studios are releasing movies. It has changed the way movies are being released, but it has changed the way that people are going to the movies as well. I'm going to say that I never went to a movie over the summer. I am still hunkered down in my basement and doing the movies via live streaming. What about yourself? Have you had the chance to go to the movie theater over the last few months?
I was so close to breaking down and going and seeing Escape Room 2 because I loved the first one. And I know what y'all are thinking. Really, that movie in the theaters, it was so cool to see. It was one of those things I went in going, this is going to be awful and I'm going to enjoy every minute of how awful it is. It was kind of good. So I wanted to see the second one. I love the cast for the second one. Indy Amore specifically being in it, and the gal they cast in the new Gossip Girl reboots in it. I love the entirety of it. So I wanted to see that in theaters because I feel like that's one of those movies you kind of have to see in theaters to really enjoy it. But I, alas, did not make it because I was mid-move from one side of the country to the other, and it's no longer there. So my heart is broken, but I'll have to find a B-run movie theater maybe that's playing it. Who knows?
For those who are unsure about what Escape Room is, I just want to clarify, and I just want to make sure I understand it. It is basically the big craze that happened a few years ago of people getting put into a room and trying to quote unquote escape. But what Hollywood did was they made it into a movie, and they made it into a horror film, correct?
Yes, it was a little bit like Saw without the gore. Which was good, because I don't like Saw for how gory it is. I like that kind of like puzzles and like race against the clock and ooh, what's the mystery? But like, I like the mystery. I like to be, you know, get my Mariska Hargitay hat on and like solve it. But yeah, I can't do the gore. So this was perfect.
And from what I understand, the second one was, hey, these are all the people who survived the first one, and they think they're escaped, but now they get locked into another escape room by the person who is doing it, correct? I'm just mixture. Going by the trailer.
Mixture. So it's people who have survived multiple versions. Mm-hmm. So this is you find out, spoiler for anyone who is really, you may want to cover your ears for half of a second. In the first one, it ends and you find out that this is something they do every year with different themes. So the theme of this year, I'm not going to say that one, you can go watch and see, but each of them has a theme. And so this is the winners of each of the themed rooms, or each of the themed escape rooms from over the few years now trapped together.
Bum, bum, bum. But it was a relatively... I think it was well received. I don't know the exact numbers. I did not look it up because I did not know you were going to talk about it. So I didn't have these numbers ready for me. But movie theaters saw an influx of people coming back. It wasn't the norm, the quote unquote normal that we were traditionally known to see before pandemic, before March of 2020. But people did start heading back to the movie theater. One area I want to talk about before we get off this whole movie theater and we get back onto what other movies we saw is this year movie companies, the actual production companies, decided that they wanted to split it. I'm talking about Disney here, and we're going to jump into a conversation that I was going to wait for later, but we're going to talk about it right now.
We can talk about it whenever.
Exactly, because that's the great thing about my show. My show, I set the rules. Disney earlier this year had been pushing back all of its movies, and it finally had a release date for Black Widow, when one of the Marvel's biggest movies, second female led movie to be released in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. And it finally came to a time where I think Disney had to say, okay, we're just going to put it out there. We're going to have it in theaters, but we're also going to put it in Disney streaming, and you're going to be able to buy it for $30 or rent it for $30 or however it works. This had pissed off the star Scarlett Johansson, because in her contract, part of the money that she would make from the movie was the movie sales. So if the movie sales in theaters did well, she would make more money. When they released it via Disney Plus, she got upset because this would take away from some of her money that she was entitled to. And Disney said, well, I'm sorry, but this is the new world order. We are now in a pandemic, and you should have thought of this when you were filming it 2 years prior to the pandemic. I'm sorry, but it is what it is. We have seen star after star come out and support. The one that I want to mention right now is Elizabeth Olsen, Scarlet Witch from WandaVision, and also from the Marvel Cinematic Universe. What is your opinion on this? Do actors need to smarten up and say, you know what? We are living in a pandemic. Movies are not going to be released solely in movie theaters anymore.
Well,
Oh, we got the tea. I'm ready. Let's go.
First of all, I find it so funny that Disney is caring about, we're in a pandemic. How could you even think that when they've had Disney World open since June of 2020? And I think, yeah, I think you can't really use the pandemic to suit your needs whenever you want. And I think Disney's kind of doing that here. Like, well, we're fine. We're safe at Disney World, but Scarlet, we're in a pandemic. People can't go to the movie theater. Like, I think we are in a new world order. I do think you're going to see a lot more movies do a split release. I think when we'll get to it when we talk about Shang-Chi, but you're, I think, going to start to see things shift towards that. We're going to start in theaters and then we're going to have it on streaming platforms, because I'm going to be honest, the streaming platform thing was super convenient to me. And it was super convenient to a lot of other people. I think if you want to do like the movie theater release, because especially for like Oscars and other award shows, that's something you do have to have. But in terms of just in general, for the general audience, we all kind of really love the watch it at home. Granted, like I said earlier, Escape Room 2 should have been seen in a bigger screen to really enjoy it. And I do think there's some movies that, like Wonder Woman 1984, if I'd seen that on a bigger screen, I think I would have liked that more, because it's just something about like the big action scenes and the explosions and the IMAX with the surround sound. I don't get that from my little itty bitty television in my house. So I think that it is the new world order. I think Scarlett Johansson's number of I've lost $50 million is a bit exaggerated. I don't think that many people would have gone to the actual theater to see it altogether. I wasn't planning on to, I was gonna wait till it was on streaming anyways, as I've been doing with a lot of the Disney movies. Yeah.
I understand where she's coming from. I completely get it. She was expecting a paycheck because the Marvel movies do make a shitload of money. This was the very first Marvel movie to come out during the pandemic. You knew it wasn't going to be the best well-received, because people are still apprehensive of going back into small crowds. Yes, Disney World has been open the entire time in Florida, but that's Florida. Let's be honest, Florida is its own unique entity. Yes, I'm sipping my tea right now.
Well, there were people that traveled from all over the world in the middle of the summer of 2020 that went, and so...
Exactly, but that's Florida, right? Disneyland was closed down. California was closed down because they saw the writing on the wall. Ron DeSantis, we're getting into politics. I'm not talking politics.
We're not doing politics. Oh no. Ah!
Exactly. But I want to talk about this because you mentioned that movies being released and then they're putting on the streaming service. A lot of the movie companies now are saying we're shortening the window that movies are in theaters. We're no longer doing the 90 days and then moving it to DVD. We're doing 45 days, and after that 45 days, it's moving to the streaming service, because we are now, like you said, it is convenient for people, and we have learned this in the last 18 months, that people are willing to just sit down at their home. They don't have to go to the movie theaters. I expect movie theaters, you will probably see them go the way of Blockbuster. People don't, like, okay, great that you want to see them on a big screen, but TVs are cheap now. You can buy a big surround sound and a big TV for $1,000.
And if you're going to buy all these streaming services, you might as well get some use out of them. So people would rather, I can either go see this movie or I can just buy this streaming service, and after a while it'll be on there.
Yeah.
They can save so much money putting it directly to their streaming service.
Yeah, I agree wholeheartedly. Over the last few months, there have been also other movies, because usually it's the summer blockbusters that do come out. This was a very weird year because there was only one or two movies that I wanted to see. And I'm usually one of those people that want to see a lot of movies. But starting with you, was there movies that piqued your interest, and what were they?
So I watched a lot of movies in this pandemic, I'm not going to lie, especially this summer. In terms of ones that I saw that I enjoyed, I really liked The Conjuring 3. I'm I'm a diehard Conjuring fan. I cannot be swayed. It was not the best in the series. It definitely was more, they've kind of hit their groove and they've realized if we want a cinematic universe, we have to do what Marvel did and have a big bad villain to fight. And so this was basically setting up who their big bad villain was, which was this cult of the Ram or something like that.
Yeah.
Overall, it wasn't scary, which was kind of disappointing because that's kind of why I wanted to watch it. But overall, it was a fun movie. I also did get to see
I watched it because my husband is a massive horror film and he believes in all this stuff. And I sat down and I watched it because he watched one of my movies with me. So I can say it was not a bad movie. I did not like the acting in the male lead. I don't know who he is, but I know I got the, if for those who are listening on audio, I just got the mouth drop from Michael.
Patrick Wilson.
I didn't like his acting. He did
Owen Wilson's brother. I'm pretty sure that's Owen Wilson's brother. I might just have opened my mouth and fucked that up, but
yeah.
Sorry for cursing.
Yeah. Oh yeah. I think they've come to realize you're going to curse, but at the end of the day, I did not like his acting. I didn't like the main bad guys acting as well.
I was right. It was Patrick Wilson.
There you go. Congratulations. You swore for no reason.
Well, there's always a reason.
I was very much tuned out of the acting. The acting did not sell it for me. The person who I did like was the
Vera.
No. The other gentleman's, the one that lived by, I forget his name, the one that lived by the river.
Oh, the priest.
Yes, the priest. There you go. I liked him because I like him to begin with. So I give it about a 5 out of 10. I wouldn't say I loved it, but I wouldn't say I'd ever watch it again either.
It's definitely one that I will watch when I do a Conjuring watch through, but it's not one of those that I'm going to reach for of like, which scary movie do I want to watch that I've seen that I know will still get me? Yeah. I'm not going to reach for Conjuring 3. I'm going to be real. I'll reach for Annabelle Creation or Annabelle Comes Home or the Conjuring 2. That nun is terrifying, but I'm not going to reach for this one, which is okay. It also was the very first movie in the entire franchise that did not feature the nun or Annabelle.
But it did.
Did it feature Annabelle?
She was in it. She wasn't active, but she was in it.
Oh, no, I'm saying it's an active scary moment.
Oh, yeah, no, but she was in it because that's how it was tying it all together, right? But I want to continue on with some of the other movies that were released this summer, and I want to get your opinion on them. I'm going to do this because I know how much we love this actor. We love this nighttime talk show host. Peter Rabbit 2, The Runaway.
Didn't see it.
Okay. And then Fast 9, the 9th installment of the Fast and the Furious movies, which is second highest grossing movie of all time in 2021.
They need to stop making Fast and the Furious movies.
One more and then they're done. They're going to 10, they said.
Bullshit.
The one I was surprised that I actually did like was The Hitman's Wife's Bodyguard with Samuel Jackson, Ryan Reynolds, and Selma Hayek. Did you see it?
I watched the last 20 minutes of it. I came home the other night and my husband was watching it.
Whoa.
So I know how it ends. I don't know how we get there, but I know how it ends.
There you go.
What a ride.
What a ride is right. I'm just looking through the list of movies that came out in June because we have not talked since June on the show. So
oh, geez, Louise.
That's why I'm just making sure. And then let's talk about July. We talked about Black. Oh, go ahead.
Cruella. She was May. She was late May.
Yeah, let's not talk about that movie.
I loved that movie. It was camp. It was fashion.
One out of 10. Okay.
Clearly, not everyone else thought so because she's getting a sequel.
Yeah, and she shouldn't because Glenn Close was a lot better in every other movie that she does. So, yeah.
I enjoyed it.
Emma Thompson is great actress, but she just doesn't do well in that movie. For those who want to send me emails, please do, because I love your feedback. I always do. You can send it to crossborderphotography@gmail.com. Or you can go to crossborderinterviews.ca and you can go to the contact form and you can fill it out and I will file it
great
away.
Plug.
You know
great plug.
I try, okay. As a horror fan, did you see Fear Street Part 1, 1984?
Okay, totally late to the game, as was said at the beginning of this. I was moving across the country. Mm-hmm. Just watched it last week, Part 1, 2, and 3. I have a lot of thoughts on these three movies.
Let's do it. Let's talk about it, because I've not seen it. I've heard good things about it, but I've not, because I'm one of those people that I will wait a few months before I see a movie that everyone's raving about, because it's going to be crappy in my opinion. But your opinion, what is it?
Wow. So the first one was...
1994.
Yeah, 1994. I absolutely loved the cast. I think the kids were brilliant. I think the story was, it's almost in the same vein as Scream. You have to look at it kind of like, this is satirizing horror and the slasher genre to propel it forward in a new direction. So it took the playbook of Scream and Halloween for the first film. So Part 1, you get that. And like in the first, you get like the Drew Barrymore moment from Scream in like the first 10 minutes, which is great, which I love to see. And it really sets the tone that they're just gonna kill anybody off, and they really stick with that. So you go in, you go, okay, I recognize a lot of this iconography from Scream, from Halloween. And then Part 2, which was 1978. It cuts to 1978, but it's still kind of mixed in with the story of 1994. And you see what happened at this Camp Night Wing. And it has very much that same vein of Friday the 13th. You see a lot of the iconography for that and a lot of the like references pulled directly from that. I think the second one was the best one in the entirety of the three. I think the first one was great. The second one was awesome. And then the third one, we
1966?
Jumped to... No, 1666.
1666, sorry, yep.
I knew there was one that was like hundreds of years later. And then it like, homegirl like goes and like touches a bone and like gets transported back. So this cast that you've watched get killed off over two movies is now playing people in the past. Okay. And it's a little jumbled. It's very much like they were trying to take like those older like witch movies like The Village or Blair Witch or the Witch that's on Netflix. Like they tried to take that vein, and it just, I think it failed, because they did it for like half of a minute and then they jumped to, and then so the first half of that movie is set 1666, and you find out what happened to the witch, Sarah Friar.
Spoiler alerts for those who have not seen it.
You would, wow. I mean, they say it from the first minute that she died that year. So you're obviously knowing that it's gonna tell you the story.
I have not seen the first two. Maybe she's in the first two. I don't know these things.
Anyways.
So I gotta ask sure. The question. Fear Street, is it based on the R.L. Stein books?
Yes.
Okay, that's what I was trying to figure out, if they were or not, and I didn't want to watch them because it's like, okay, I remember reading those and I don't want to screw it up, so that's why I was hesitant to watch it.
I would say watch the first two and then sit in your room and cry that they didn't have enough money to make the third one. The third one was nothing to write home. I just felt like the first two were so strong, and then the third one almost felt like they had, okay, you got a trilogy, and they wanted four movies, because then all of a sudden, an hour into it, it cuts back to the main story for 1994 Part 2 and like finishes it, and then it becomes like an Avengers type movie.
Wow, ruining the whole thing now. Now I'm not going to watch it now. I give it a 1 out of 10. That's right.
All I mean, I would give... I would say, no, I said watch the first two and then pretend the third one doesn't exist.
Nope, 1 out of 10. 1 out of 10 for across the board. You've just ruined it for me. There you go. For those who are listening and watching who have not seen the movie, please send your mail to Michael Nichols Pate, and he can be linked in the show notes. So please do that. Greatly appreciate it.
I mean, wow. It's not... really any spoil, because I'm so crazy about spoilers. I've given nothing away. I'm just saying they have that, like,
you say a witch dies. I didn't know that was going to happen. Now I know that that's going to happen. You say that it's Avengers thing, so I'm assuming that Chris Evans is going to show up with Captain America.
Like, sadly, no. That would make it better. No, it's like the witch dying, like in Hocus Pocus, like the witches die. Just saying. No,
they don't, because they come back for the second one, which we're going to be talking about here soon, but it's okay. Yeah, sip your tea. The next movie I want to talk about is Space Jam Legacy. Or is that what it's called? A New Legacy, sorry. With LeBron James, I have not seen this movie because I liked the first one and I refuse to see something that does not have Michael Jordan in it. So did you see this movie?
So this is where I'm going to get crucified. Not for spoiling Fear Street. I've never seen the first Space Jam, ever. So I did not watch the sequel. I've heard it was all right. I didn't hear anything spectacular about it.
Okay. Doesn't seem like there's much in July, because usually there isn't, because of the whole, like, you know, school's out and people want to do things. Let's jump into August. The first one I want to talk about here, which we just watched, my husband and I, The Suicide Squad.
Oh, yeah. I forgot to put that on my list. I just watched that one, too.
We did, too. We watched it last weekend. It was one of those movies that we're like, okay, let's see it. Let's see what's going to, let's see what the big craze is all about. So we watched it, and James Gunn, director of the Guardian of the Galaxy movies in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, was fired from the Marvel Cinematic Universe, and then Marvel Cinematic Universe, and I'm saying Marvel Cinematic Universe a lot right now, but then they, after they fired them, they went, oh crap, he's going over to DC, so we gotta hire him back, guys. Hire him back, screw whatever he said in the past, but let's hire him back. DC hired him to do the Suicide Squad because Suicide Squad, the very first movie, was not well received. I liked it. I would have given it an 8 out of 10 because I enjoy how they portrayed Harley Quinn. I loved how they portrayed Captain Boomerang, Rick Flag, the whole kit and caboodle. So I was going into this thinking that it was going to be Guardians of the Galaxy meets the Suicide Squad, because James Gunn is that type of director and he seems to like to mold things together. But I was pleasantly surprised. I was actually pleasantly surprised at how well he made this movie. And the entire time, and this is no spoilers, don't expect your favorite person to survive. Because I went into this movie thinking that I knew who was going to survive, because you expect to know who's going to survive and who's not. And I was pleasantly surprised that they were like, nope, whoever you think, we're going to just do whatever we want with them. What's your thoughts?
I'm just shocked they got that weasel to sign on. You know, Pete Davidson.
Oh wow.
No, I liked it. It was gory. It was gorier than the first one, and that's saying something. Well, the first one was pretty gory.
James Gunn does that, right? He just goes crazy and goes to town on that type of stuff.
I mean, it was interesting. I mean, I think Harley Quinn has the most interesting story arc in the entirety of the DC extended universe, specifically going from like the first Suicide Squad to Birds of Prey to the second Suicide Squad. I mean, it's like nobody knows what to do with her, but Margot Robbie is carrying literally the entire DCEU on her back.
Yeah.
And I need Homegirl to like take a break. She's doing a lot of carrying and she needs to let someone else do it. And I'm not saying that because it's her fault. I'm saying it's the writers basically now putting everything onto her.
Well, DC's always done better at TV shows than Marvel has done. Well, besides the three that I've just recently released with Marvel, Loki, WandaVision, Falcon, and Winter Soldier. But DC has an entity that they're willing to promote, and Margot Robbie seems to enjoy doing these movies. So she's willing to just sign the contract, get paid, and put on the makeup for an hour, and then she's good.
Yeah, I mean, she's brilliant in this movie. I think out of all of the cast, I was so excited watching her. And there's a very large cast. I also really liked King Shark. And I just wish that, I really hope that there is green screen footage of Sylvester Stallone dressed as the shark, like running around.
I will agree to that as well, because that would make this whole pandemic worth it.
Like him like cheering and clapping and running. Because I mean, the shark acts like a toddler and I just need that green screen footage.
Okay. I'm just looking through the list right now. The last one I want to talk about is another Ryan Reynolds movie that was supposed to be released earlier this year, but it was just recently released. Free Guy with him and I want to
Taika Waititi.
There you go. Him and Ryan Reynolds did a movie together over the, I think 2 years ago, and it finally got released. This was a better version of Ready Player One, which was filmed and directed by Steven Spielberg. Have you seen it?
No, it is just movie theaters right now.
Yeah. So.
And I have not. And also, one of those. It's not one of those movies that I'm necessarily going to go out of my way to see in a theater. I'll just wait for them to kind of put it on. I'm sure I'll enjoy it, but just like with Ready Player One, like it'll be a fun watch. I don't know if I necessarily want to pay the $20 to go see a movie, see it in theaters. It's not one of those that I was like, oh my God, this is something I need.
That's true. And I'm the same way. I'm looking forward to it. I'm still looking forward to seeing Avatar. I can't wait for that to be coming completely free, where I do not have to pay one single dime of electricity or anything to watch that movie.
Avatar? The blue people or the...
Yeah, the blue people. I still haven't seen it. I refuse to watch it. I gave too much money to James Cameron for Titanic. I do not need to give him more money for her.
That was a choice.
The first three times were a choice. The fourth, fifth, and sixth time were my fault. Seventh time was just complete ignorance.
Well, damn.
Hey,
good old
21 hours of my life I want back.
I've never seen that.
You've never seen Titanic?
No, it came out when I was 5.
I'm young. Oh, look at me. Jackass. I mean, for those who are listening who are part of Michael's family, he's a great guy. He's awesome.
No, I'm not. They'll tell you I'm an asshole.
You said it. I didn't. I want to talk about TV shows during the summer as well.
Wait. Movies. We forgot some.
What ones did we forget over the summer?
Jungle Cruise.
I have not seen that. That's why I didn't mention it.
Oh, I saw it. I shockingly really liked it.
Really?
Yeah. I thought it was a lot of fun.
Yeah. This is going to sound very bad. I'm not a Jack Whitehall fan.
Is he who directed it?
No, he's the gay character in it.
Oh, it's like gay light. Disney went the farthest they ever went with actually saying a character was gay, but they don't outright say he's gay.
Shocker.
But it's more than we have a gay character in Beauty and the Beast and it's LeFou dancing with a man for 10 seconds at the end.
And his secret crush on Gaston.
Yeah.
Which is ironic because the straight guy plays the gay guy and the gay guy plays the straight guy, but it's okay.
Yeah. And then, The Rock was really good. Emily Blunt's extraordinary. I mean, she's an extraordinary actress. I've always been a fan of hers. I will fight anyone who says that they don't like her. Fight. I'll put fisticuffs up.
I like how your fisticuffs are like right near your face. You're like fisticuffs.
Well, that's because I'm like the computer and like the microphone. I'm like very boxed in. It's a little claustrophobic at the moment.
Coming from someone who lives in New York and who's lived in LA. So yeah, nice try. Claustrophobic, my butt. What other movies did you watch during the summer that came out?
Those are the only ones I've watched that came out, but I want to see Luca still. I know it's on Disney Plus. Did you get a chance to watch that?
Which one? Sorry. I just got a text. Luca? Yes, we did watch that on Disney.
Calamari Plus. By Your Name.
How do I say this? I enjoyed it.
Okay.
But I didn't enjoy it.
Fair.
It did not remind me of a Disney movie. It felt more like I was watching a, and they probably went this way, but it felt more like they were going in the realm of, we're Disney, but we're not Disney. And I enjoyed that because it didn't have the, I'm just trying to think if they actually did have music. I don't think they did, right?
No.
Yeah. And that's what I liked. I was like, okay, it's an actual movie. I can sit down. Watching it with someone of a Latin descent, it was interesting. It pushed the envelope a little bit, and of Spanish descent, because it was like based in Spanish and Greece and all that.
I thought it was in Greece.
There was a very big Spanish undertone.
Gotcha. Okay. I've not seen it yet.
Yeah. It wasn't bad. I would give it about a 6. Because it does, I think it's an hour and 45 minutes long, if I'm not mistaken. And you could probably have cut it down to about an hour and 10. Because there are parts in that movie that you go, okay, what was that all about? And it's a Disney movie in the sense that you know what's going to happen. You're like, okay. Like within 2 minutes, you're like, okay, X, Y, and Z are all going to happen. And we're all happy about that. So.
Yeah.
What other movies?
Come on. There's two more that I had put on my list that I've not seen that I want to. Respect, the Aretha Franklin, just came out last Friday. And it's only in theaters right now. It has Jay Hud. And Jay Hud's probably going to win the Oscar for it. I've been hearing that. It's just Jay Hud singing. And that's what won her the Oscar for Dreamgirls.
But they will not give it to her because they've already given it. They'll probably give it to somebody else. Like a Frances McDormand.
I don't want to talk about this year's Oscars. You know what? I'm done talking about the Oscars. Moving on.
or for some reason, they'll give it to Anthony Hopkins.
He deserved it. He deserved it. Anyways, in the last one that I'm actually probably going to watch after we finish filming today is a documentary on Netflix, Pray Away, about the gay conversion camps.
Okay, yeah.
That came out. That's on my list to watch. That I'm excited to angrily watch that with my ice cream and yell at my television because it's going to make me mad. But it's a fascinating documentary that I think is important to watch. So. And that's all I have for movies.
Well, it's better than what I did this summer because I literally watched like Mighty Ducks 1, 2, and 3 over again. So
that's just some choices were made.
Yes, they were. I went on a Disney kick for a while. I watched the 3 Caballeros. It was fun. Oh, no, come. Don't come at me, okay? Don't tweet me. Don't be all that in a bag of potato chips. But I made choices this summer, okay? I was going through radiation. I'm going through radiation. Yeah, you sip your tea. I want to talk about TV shows now. Sure. This one's gonna be quick because we're gonna do the recap of the summer and then we'll talk about the new ones that are coming out. Okay.
Sure.
Okay, so what TV shows were you watching this summer? And I will start with mine. And I think for those who have been listening, realize that I'm a massive nerd and I enjoy Marvel Cinematic Universe. So Loki was one of my top choices for this summer. It was a fun. Shockingly great show.
I enjoyed it. There is one character in particular I loved. The alligator.
Crokey or whatever is it?
Crokey.
I feel like I want to get a croconut now. Crokey was good. I will give you that. I think Marvel bet on the wrong horse on this show because they bet that Mrs. the little clock. I forget her name right now. Time, Miss Time.
Oh, I think they thought we were gonna love her. Really, we hate a snitch.
Yeah, and then it became Crokey became the number one hit. It is the new Baby Yoda.
Well, nothing can ever replace my Baby Yoda, but Crokey, if he's back, he might.
Ooh, Marvel, you heard that. You bring back Crokey for season 2 and we'll be good, which isn't going to come out for another 2.5 years.
Which also, like, season 2. I didn't want a season 2. I think you need
to.
But they're going to wrap it. I mean, allegedly, allegedly Loki is in Multiverse of Madness.
Yep.
So like they're gonna clearly have to wrap those stories up in Multiverse.
No.
I just want more WandaVision.
That's done.
I know. I don't like that. You know, we don't need Captain Falcon and the Winter Whatever. Boring.
FYI, Captain Anthony Mackie, the new Captain America, has his own movie coming out now, Captain Fabulous. America 4, which is great. Season 2 of Captain America and Winter... For those who have not watched it, I apologize, spoilers, but Captain America and Winter Soldier, Season 2 is going to be coming out as well. So
they're getting a Season 2?
Yeah.
And WandaVision gets nothing.
WandaVision was a limited series where... I'm triggered. Wow. We'll talk about that during the Emmy predictions, okay? Because there's things that were triggered me during those Emmy nominations that I went, what the hell is that person got nominated for? But let's just leave that at that. The other one that I watched during the summer, and it might have come out right at the end or right before the summer break, but The Mighty Ducks Game Changer.
Stamos?
No, that's the big game. That was a good freaking move. That was a good TV show. I for Disney Plus fans, please go to Disney Plus and search John Stamos, because you will not be sadly, you will not be upset that I've recommended this show. The Big Game, or the big whatever the hell it's called. That's how bad I can't even remember it right now. It's about a former college coach who is at the top of game, gets suspended. Oh, I love that show.
You got it, dude.
Go watch it. But yes, that plus also The Mighty Ducks. So those are my two that I watched this summer when it came to new TV shows. Yourself?
I totally missed my Full House reference, and I'm very sad now.
Oh, I got it. I just ignored it.
And you!
I know when you're trying to bait me, Michael. Okay? So I just go, nope, not even close.
I'm so sad. Let's see. I watch a lot of television stuff. I think it's a great way to tell a story. And a lot of times, a lot of these movies should be a TV show with multiple episodes versus an actual movie. I watched a lot of the stuff that I watched did this like half split between the season, like half the summer, and then it's coming back later in the fall, just so they can say they have a fall premiere. One of those I watched that I really loved was the new Gossip Girl reboot, that I think I went in going, this is going to be bad. And I think the
move too late. I already think it's bad.
No. The move to HBO Max, I think, was a really good thing, because it's allowing them to be a little edgier with stories. Cause when it was on the CW, it was like the fact that she was photographed in her underwear as an adult was like the biggest scandal you could do on television. Whereas now it's like, oh, he's sleeping with his teacher. Like, you didn't really get that when Gossip Girl was originally on. And I think it's an interesting look at like,
it's where, not on CW, is it?
No, it's on HBO Max. They were thinking of putting it on CW, but then they were like, well, we can be edgier on HBO Max. As evidence of Titans, which also I just came back a month or two, three weeks ago, which I started watching. I enjoyed that, which that is season 3 of the like gritty version of the Teen Titans. I don't know if you watched that one. Do you?
I watched the first season. I did not get into it because I'm a comic book fan, right? So I know the Titans from the comic books, and I see which route they're trying to go. It just wasn't for me.
It's fun. I don't know the comics. I enjoy
Why are we friends again? Why are we friends? Seriously, wow.
Sorry. What else? Oh, Evil on Paramount Plus.
Don't even.
You don't like it, or you do?
Okay. So Paramount Plus. Okay, for those who are listening, and get ready. Just sip your tea for a bit, because I've got to express some anger for the next 10 seconds.
All right, I'm gonna go get another drink because I'm out of tea while you yell.
Go for it. For those who have not seen Evil season 1, please find it on any streaming service and download it, because it is one of the best shows that was on CBS for a very, very, very long time. Now, CBS decided to cancel it. They were not doing the weekly broadcast of CBS on CBS, so they canceled Evil on CBS, and they picked it up on Paramount Plus, which at that time I think was like Viacom or whatever the hell it was, the first iteration of Evil, Paramount Plus. So they did that. I was excited. I bought the $5.99 per month Paramount Plus to watch it. I was excited to watch it. I was looking forward to seeing season two. Season two launched this summer. Paramount Plus has this issue with Canada. We don't like Canada. I tweeted at them during the summer and I said, hey, you have just released episode one. Why can't Canadians watch it? I got nothing back. The star of the show, the female, I forget her name, tweeted back at me and said, hey, Canadian viewers, you will get it on Sunday. I'm like, awesome. This Sunday, so it comes out the week after it airs in America. I'm okay with that. Sunday rolls around. Paramount Plus hasn't updated. Monday rolls around, hasn't updated. A week goes by, nothing. 2 weeks go by, nothing. I'm getting furious because I'm trying to watch this as it comes out. Last week, Paramount Plus removes Evil from its catalog in Canada. I am furious that I cannot watch season two of this show. So Paramount Plus, get your act together, stop jerking us around in Canada, and release Evil on Paramount Plus. It's not that fucking hard. There's my rant for the day. Thanks for coming to my TED Talk.
I loved Evil. The second half of the season starts, I guess, just in the U.S. on Sunday.
Really?
Get a VPN.
We don't do that. We are fine, upstanding members of society as Canadians. We don't do things like you Americans.
I'm a goblin. What can I say?
I am sorry, but I was pissed.
No, definitely. I mean, it's the fact that there's some things that air in some areas and not others is kind of problematic.
Well, RuPaul Drag Race. We don't get RuPaul's Drag Race on Paramount Plus.
You can get WoW Plus Presents.
We can't get that in Canada.
You can't get RuPaul's damn thing that he airs all his damn 800 different versions of the damn Drag Race.
Not one. Paramount Plus has... Like America is, I know you guys aren't an island, but you guys seem like you're acting like Hawaii. Hey, look at us. We're on a special island. Smarten up, guys. I know for the border crossers and probably like FBI who are listening to this, I probably will never be let back into America ever again. But smarten the damn up, because I want to watch Evil Season 2. It's not that hard.
I will say, and this is not a jab, I think the move to Paramount Plus is better for the show.
Oh, probably.
Because they can curse. They can get a little more graphic than they could on TV. It's the same level of scary as the first season, which is not scary, but there's moments.
I love the antagonist in the show. I love him. I love his character. I love him. I love him as an actor.
He plays a great villain.
Exactly. So I'm pissed off that it's not coming. But anyway, there's my rant. I apologize for that. Evil is great. Please watch it. But at the end of the day, CBS, get it to fucking Canada.
All righty. So in that vein, I also may or may not have watched High School Musical, the musical, the series, season 2.
Okay, so look at the time there, everyone. We're heading into the last hour of the show, and I just want to talk about
your... awful. It was everything. I had so much fun watching it. It's not one of those shows you watch going, wow, this is a good show. You watch it going, this is fun.
Is it?
Sometimes girls just want to have fun.
No.
Cindy Lauper told us that.
No, she told me that I just time after time and I'm good. Is there any other movies, TV shows that you watch before we move into the music genre and then we talk about what's coming up?
I mean, what's coming up in terms of, there's a TV show that you're going to roll your eyes.
Okay, but so is this what was happening during the summer? Or is this what's coming up?
It's coming up, so we can
save. Okay, so we'll save it for the coming up section.
So my last, oh, we didn't even get, oh my God, Drag Race.
Okay, I knew you were going to talk about that. Hi, everyone. My name is Christopher Brown, and welcome to my second TED Talk of the episode. I am sick and tired of Drag Race. Don't get me wrong. I appreciate everything that the drag queens do, and he is sipping his pop right now because he is officially tuned out of my speech because he has heard this numerous times over the last month.
Time after time after
Don't get me wrong.
Time after time.
RuPaul All-Stars 5. RuPaul season 12, RuPaul Thailand, RuPaul England season 2 or UK season 2, RuPaul Down Under season 1, RuPaul's nice. All-Stars 6, RuPaul season 2-3 of the UK, RuPaul season 2 of Drag Race Canada, because it's not actually RuPaul's Drag Race, it's Drag Race Canada.
He doesn't put his name on it if he doesn't host it.
Exactly.
So Drag Race Holland, Drag Race Thailand, Drag Race Spain's been going on this summer. Holland's currently happening. Australia did happen this summer, which that was a giant yikes.
So I am done. I have sat for the last 18 months and watched enough RuPaul Drag Race to understand what tuck, what fish, what all these terms that people have been telling me over the last 20 odd years that I finally figured them out. And I can say with all certainty that I am done. Don't get me wrong, she will still produce. I will still probably talk about it. But at the end of the day, I'm not sitting down and actually dealing with anything RuPaul ever again. There's my TED Talk for this 5-minute segment. Thanks for coming to it. Over to you, Michael.
Well, you're going to have to deal with it for a second because I'm about to talk about it.
Go for it. Okay, I'm going to go get myself a coffee now.
Yeah, I think that this is one of the stronger seasons in a long time. I think that by doing an all-star season with a cast that isn't just the final four, it's a lot of casts that was in between or went home early, and a lot of casts that people have been begging to see made it a really strong, fun season. Would I call it an all-star season? No, they're doing a lot of regular season challenges. But I think this is just working, whereas the last few times haven't. Also, this is one of the first seasons where you really don't quite know who the winner is going to be. It could be any number of like 4 or 5 different people. And even from the beginning, normally, like when we watched All Stars 5, you and I, the first conversation we had about it, I said, Shay's winning the whole thing. Because it's predictable. It was one of those things that I predicted going in. And then this one, I don't know. I know who I want and I know who should be the winner, but that doesn't necessarily mean that they're going to. So. Oh, you mean the fracking?
Nope. Hey, you watch what you want to watch. RuPaul's All-Star 6. I have watched 2 episodes of the show. I watched last week's and the week before that.
Last week's was good.
Sure it was. Sure.
Wow. It was. I'm triggered. Now I'm triggered again.
Oh, Puddin', you want a lollipop? Deal with it. I went there. I am sorry. I'm going to say this once and only once. I said this to you via text after I watched it. BKTBJW.
You cannot XYZ. Say a single word about my Trinity.
Trinity K Bonet. There you go. Okay. I understand you're tired. I understand you're being tucked all day. Your attitude towards this game within a game, this, oh no, things are going to change now, needs to smarten up. Okay. Understandable. You're upset. You're angry. You're tired, probably. But it's RuPaul's Drag Race. You have seen the last 5 seasons. Things happen. Things change, okay? Deal with it.
So I do think she got a dirty edit there. because there was definite times when other queens were cheering that you could see her cheering in the background. They chose to only use, like, yes, she was doing those not so great things, or she was looking tired and annoyed, which that I'm not gonna say, oh, how dare you, you did, you, that was pretend. No, that was real. But there was times she was cheering that editing just totally didn't, which is why it's leading me to believe that she's probably going home, which is maddening because I think she should win it. But anyways, that's enough RuPaul. I could talk RuPaul all day.
I gotta ask the question because I want to get this on record, so the next time we talk I can throw it in your face. Who is going to be the saved queen? So for those who didn't watch, and I did watch this, so I can say this, the game within a game of All-Star Season 6 was the eliminated queens would go up against each other for a all-out lip sync for your legacy slash life slash all-around amazing person slash hey, you could possibly be saved slash Ruzapalooza slash Musicalpalooza slash whatever the hell you want to talk about it. But the eliminated queens would one by one be put up against each other. So episode 1 and episode 2, they went up against each other. The winner would move on to the eliminated queen for season 3 and so on and so forth. Silky Nutmeg Ganache, or however you want to pronounce her name, was the overall winner for six lip syncs. Let's be honest, 5, because the one that I'm thinking of did not count in my opinion, because Akiria Davenport decided to walk off and not do the game within the game because she left on her own terms. Good for her. I know Michael wants to jump in here and tell me something that she said something afterwards, but anyway, it's here nor there. So Silky Nutmeg Ganache and Eureka, who was eliminated the week before, went up against each other and a epic battle of battles of whatever the hell you want to call
epic.
It.
Epic.
Well, Silky Nutmeg Ganache tried to get out of her transformation, and it really stuck. For some reason, Eureka was wearing a life alert bracelet when she was on the floor. I was hoping that she would press it just to get people to come and help her up, but it did not happen. Hey, I feel like Michael is laughing at me right now, but I'm going to say, they danced to "Since You've Been Gone" by Kelly Clarkson. And I can tell you right now, since they've been gone, I did not miss them. I wish they both were gone and they did not come back, but it is what it is. So with that, I've got to ask the question. Out of the two remaining queens, Silky Nutmeg Ganache and Eureka, Michael, who is going to be saved and who is going to go back in the top 5 to be reduced to the top 4 next week?
So, I think the fact Silky won 6 should instantly put her into the top 5. However,
it was a bad performance.
It was bad. She could, if she had been able to get her, because she was so strong at the beginning and Eureka was like flailing and crying and weeping and whatever.
Life
whatever.
Alert.
Yeah. If they had put Silky in, if Silky had been able to get her costume off and do her reveal, I think she would have been the one coming back. But I think she couldn't get it off and it was attached to her the entire rest of the time. It was really sloppy. I think overall it was underwhelming. Now, I wouldn't have taken either of them back. I know there's a lot of people pushing for, we're going to bring them both back. They're not going to do that. With the number of episodes left this season, they're not doing that.
So you think it's just going to be 2?
It's just going to be Eureka.
It's going to be Eureka?
I think it's going to be Eureka. And I think that Eureka basically has to win the episode following, or she's gone again. And so honestly, I think they're going to throw it to Eureka because they've been basically, there's been times she's been terrible that they've let her skip out of the bottom. There's been times that she's just been safe when she shouldn't have been. I think that they're going to, because they want her in the top 4, they're going to push her through. And unfortunately, I think that's going to lead to the demise of Trinity, who should be top 4 and who should honestly be top 2 with Kylie or Raja.
So gun to your head, and I know I shouldn't say that, but gun to your head, who's the winner of season All-Star 6?
Is it who I think should win, or who's going to win?
Who should win and who will win?
Since I think Trinity's going home, I do think she should win, but if she does in fact go home, like I'm thinking they're setting it up to with all the editing stuff they're doing, because the show is very predictable once you've watched a billion seasons of it, I think Kylie or Raja should win. My money's more on Kylie. However, I think that Ginger is going to win because the way production's been really just aggressively pushing her. They gave her like triple the screen time that Pandora even got. And Pandora was there like right up to the final six and she was barely in the fucking thing. So I think that they're really being like, look at Ginger, Ginger, Ginger. And it's like,
Okay, so I think you're right. I think Ginger will win. I hope for the star factor, and this is me being me, I think Eureka should win because she has the bigger pull probably at shows. She plays well in Midwestern states, which Raja, Ginger, and Kylie probably don't.
I don't know.